Good evening and welcome everyone to our webinar broadcast at the forefront of parathyroid disease post-surgery. Tonight we will have the opportunity to hear from Dr. Susan Pitt from the Division of Endocrine Surgery at the University of Wisconsin Department of Surgery. So without further ado, I'll turn this over to her.
Hi, thank you all for joining us tonight. I just want to start by letting you know I'm a little bit sick, so I may cough some through this. If you have any questions, please, put them up and type them into your little area on your screen. I have seen in several of the questions that were submitted beforehand and tried to incorporate them all into the presentation, so hopefully I'll be able to answer a bunch of those as we go along. And definitely please type in if you're having any trouble hearing us. So just to get started, so you've had your parathyroidectomy, what are we going to do now? So the number one thing I think a lot of patients get worried about are complications. Things that people don't tend to think about but are often one of the most common complications is actually just failure of surgery. In well-experienced endocrine surgeons, this is about 2 or 3%, but by sort of a general surgeon's on a whole, it can be up to 10% depending upon what studies you look at. The other things that patients can get, and I'll talk about a little bit more in depth, are the hypocalcemia or hypoparathyroidism, where you get some numbness and tingling in your fingers around your mouth or in your toes and some cramping of your muscles. And then recurrent laryngeal nerve injuries, which can cause hoarseness, and that's the nerve that controls your vocal cords. Patients can also get bleeding or infection. And I'll mention this briefly also, the thyrotoxicosis or hyperthyroidism afterwards. These are all pretty uncommon, but I'll touch on each of them. So hypocalcemia, this is really the number one thing that we think about afterwards, because you've come in, your calcium's been high, and your parathyroid hormone level's been high, and suddenly your parathyroid or parathyroids that are causing this get taken out, and so now your calcium tends to drop after surgery. And so doctors will put you on different types of calcium supplements, and I'll go over those too. You'll get the symptoms that I mentioned. And then, one of the questions is, when do you really need calcitriol? And that's mostly, it's very surgeon dependent, but if your calcium or your parathyroid hormone level is too low or very low after surgery, the calcitriol is added to help you absorb the extra calcium. And so your symptoms, if they're not responding to the calcium supplements that you're already taking, oftentimes if that's the case, then your physician will also add the calcitriol in at that point. The additional thing, if you have long-term hypocalcemia or hypoparathyroidism that's lasting at least 6 months, there's a new treatment, which is recombinant parathyroid hormone, which is basically a synthetic parathyroid hormone. It's called NatPara. You can see it, the name of it down on the right lower part of your screen. And that's a new option for patients. It used to be just the long-term calcitriol and calcium. Now, it doesn't fix the problem 100%, but it makes patients not have to take calcium quite as frequently. And so what happens to your labs after surgery? And this isn't the best graph in the world. I'll apologize for that. You can see, so this is sort of your calcium range up here, and you've got the calcium in this maroon color. And so it starts really high, and then it'll dip down, and sometimes it kind of goes below the lower limit of normal before it corrects. And the parathyroid hormone can actually do the same thing. It'll start very, very high, come down here lower, and pop back up. And so the range for parathyroid hormone is here. And so the reason why we do supplement is because in this time period, if this is the number of days after surgery, so 2 weeks is right around here, and that 2 weeks between surgery and when you come back, your calcium level might go too low. And so we give you supplements to prevent having symptoms during that time. And one of the other things I'll sort of point out here is that sometimes the parathyroid hormone level might be a little bit elevated when you come back at 2 weeks, but your calcium is normal or low, and this is just because it'll rebound up before it slowly corrects over time. We'll talk about it at the end, and it's way out at this time point at 6 months that we really define cure, because you can see this sort of rebound, and it's because the parathyroid hormone here, you know, the rest of your parathyroids that are left are responding to this low calcium that you've had. And so calcium supplements, this was one of the major questions that I saw in the questions that were submitted. It can really depend upon your surgeon in terms of what types do you take. They're given, like I said, to prevent symptoms. And then if you are developing symptoms of low calcium, that numbness or tingling or cramping, you can take extra to treat it. And you basically can't, you know, take too much calcium afterwards, you know, so you can keep taking them until your symptoms go away. There is a limit to how much your body can absorb at a time, and we'll talk about in a minute about kind of when to call your doctor. And so the dose that they might send you home on or the type that they send you home on depends somewhat on what your calcium or your parathyroid hormone level was after surgery, so post-op. And then the type of supplement, some surgeons just have a preference. Some surgeons will defer to patient's preference. We tend to recommend Tums or any type of chewable calcium carbonate because it's absorbed faster. So when you're getting those symptoms after surgery, the calcium gets back into your bloodstream better. Some surgeons will recommend the calcium citrate because they're quote-unquote stronger, and sort of per pill you can get more active calcium into the body, and that's sort of the idea, but you're more likely to have constipation and stomach upset, and so there's sort of pluses and minus to each of the different types of calcium. And then people who have any kind of malabsorption problems, so they don't absorb certain things, they have celiac disease, or they've had a history of, you know, a gastric bypass, so they've had weight loss surgery, they can have trouble absorbing calcium, in which case we'll recommend calcium citrate, and sometimes even very difficult to get type of calcium citrate that's in a liquid form. And so in terms of calcium supplements, this is just to show you it's variable by surgeon, and that's why you might have a difficult time on the internet trying to find a particular recommendation. This is one algorithm where they base it on what your calcium level is before surgery. So then in your first week and then second week after surgery, they'll tell you to take so many pills. They'll give you Rocaltrol if you're had hyperplasia or particularly high calcium. Our protocol here at the University of Wisconsin is very slightly from this, but we basically base it on the parathyroid hormone level, which is your last level in the operating room, and we decide whether or not to give you Tums or the calcium carbonate two or three times a day, and then if your PTH level is pretty low, we'll add the calcitriol in on top of that to help you absorb the calcium that you're otherwise taking. The other kind of complication that's one of the main ones that people talk about is the recurrent nerve injury, which can cause hoarseness. Most of the time, if this happens, it's a transient event, and only about 5 or 15% of patients will get it. Usually takes about 1 to 6 months to recover, and you may or may not have a laryngoscopy, which basically is a video, that camera that goes through your nose and looks at your vocal cords to see if they're functioning. Now, you can also get permanent vocal cord paralysis, and this is usually because the cord, or not the cord, the nerve itself is cut, or just say you have some sort of tumor on it, or it's really kind of manipulated a lot during surgery. If it doesn't come back within the first year, it's pretty unlikely to ever come back, but you can have things done kind of before then or after where they inject the vocal cord. I like to describe this like the lip fillers that a lot of the celebrities get to make their lips look big and puffy. It's basically the same thing, because your vocal cord atrophies because it's a muscle, so it gets, you know, basically all skinny when it's not working because the nerve's not working it, and so they inject it basically with a filler, like a collagen kind of thing, and try to increase it, and that makes the voice trouble improve. And then there's other surgeries that you can have done. And you can see in terms of this, the parathyroids aren't drawn on this, but this is the thyroid where this is a person's head is kind of over here to the screen left, and then over here to the right would be the feet. The thyroid's pulled up, and this is the back, and the front would be up here, so somebody's kind of laying on their back on the side. And the nerve can be kind of really up and in here, and the parathyroids are right back here as well, and so That's how you can get an injury to the parathyroid during surgery. So one of the questions that we had was about thyrotoxicosis or hyperthyroidism. If your thyroid manipulated a lot during surgery, or if, you know, sometimes the parathyroids are stuck near the upper part of the thyroid and we have to take some of the blood supply of the upper part down in order to find it, then you can basically, that part of the thyroid isn't getting enough blood supply, and as those cells die, they release all the thyroid hormone within them, and you can get hyperthyroidism. People can get, the biggest thing they'll get is this irregular heart rate. They can get tremors of their hand or trouble sleeping. Their blood pressure might go up. They might feel nervous or like you're having an anxiety attack. And I know we had a question about this. So this resolves usually in about 4 weeks and is self-limited. And you kind of decide to treat the symptoms as you need to. It's very uncommon. Less than 1 in 100 people will experience this. And you kind of decide, you know, depending upon how either irregular or fast the heart rate is, you might decide to give someone a beta blocker or some other type of heart medication that will slow that heart rate down. We usually will check the levels because the thyroid hormone itself can take, 2 to 4 weeks to change at all. You may have some of the symptoms early on without having abnormal levels, and then as your symptoms actually start going away, your levels go up. There's just like a time lag with that. In terms of when to go to the ER, kind of the biggest reason is if you're having bleeding. So these are two pictures of people who have a whole lot of swelling underneath their, you know, incision. And basically, the thing to do is to evacuate or get rid of the blood clot that's in there. And they will actually do this awake sometimes and just take the stitches out after kind of numbing up the skin if there's time to do that, and then take you to the operating room afterwards. If there's time and you're breathing okay, then we'll take you to the operating room first. The other main reason is if you're having low calcium that's not responding to supplements, usually you can call your surgeon because sometimes they'll call in the calcitriol and have you check your labs as an outpatient before you go to the ER. But some patients will need IV calcium, but it's pretty uncommon to need that. So what about my pathology? And I put this in here mostly because there were some questions about parathyroid cancer. But I just added sort of this general slide about adenomas versus double adenomas and hyperplasia. Obviously, an adenoma is the most common, followed by hyperplasia, and a double adenoma is pretty uncommon. But one of the questions was about hyperplasia, if there was any indication for testing for MEN genes, and MEN is disorders, MEN1 and MEN2 are multiple endocrine neoplasias, and they're basically when you have parathyroid disease associated with other types of cancers or abnormalities that can be of the thyroid or the adrenal glands or the pancreas or the pituitary gland, and really unless there's family history of those other disorders, there's no need to worry about having an MEN problem or needing to get tested for it. In terms of parathyroid cancer, the treatment is really just surgery. There's no radiation or chemotherapy for parathyroid cancer, and so, you know, surgery is basically removal of the parathyroid, which often involves removing, I showed over here, half of the thyroid itself. And we used to recommend removing the lymph nodes in the area, but the most recent guidelines that came out within the last year does not recommend lymph node removal. And then basically, after surgery, the main thing to do is surveillance. And so you test the calcium and the parathyroid hormone level, you know, every 3 to 6 months in that very first time period, and then every 6 months, and then you kind of spread it out after that depending upon how someone is doing. But these are common to come back, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. So what about my incision? There were some questions that were submitted about how to take care of the wound. The first thing I'll say is listen to your doctor. Most surgeons kind of have preferences, and so I would defer to whoever your surgeon is. things that we recommend here at Wisconsin after that initial two-week period are basically wound massage. So you can actually go right on top of it and make little circles, go up and down, make little zigzags or horizontal movements, and that really helps it flatten out. And I don't know if any of you have had the experience where your scar kind of moves as you swallow. It helps prevent that too because it breaks up that scar tissue. We also recommend silicone patches. These are some examples of before and after scar use with the silicone patches, and it's something that's used to prevent keloid formation like this. And these products are all different types or brands that you can get. CVS and Walgreens both make generic. These are some of the brand names. And then there's creams like Mederma that I know of. There's no data to actually support any of these that doesn't also have data that doesn't support it. And so I think it's really kind of your preference in terms of what you would like to use. We've had some good outcomes with the silicone patches here. So how about symptoms? I've got a bunch of slides here, and a few of them I'll go over more quickly. But I just sort of wanted to let you all know what should you expect after surgery. So this is just sort of a slide showing the strongest evidence versus the weakest evidence for what you're going to see. So we know that you're going to have an improved bone health, improved sense of sort of well-being and quality of life, and a decrease in the risk of kidney stones. Whether or not musculoskeletal complaints, so bone pain or joint pain and muscle aches goes away, or abdominal complaints or reflux, there's sort of intermediate evidence. And then there's sort of the weakest evidence for blood pressure, diabetes, or even risk of death from cardiovascular disease, but I'm going to show you at least some studies that discuss each of these. So in terms of pre-surgery symptoms, these are all the things that patients can get, and this is how often we tend to see them. So the most common things are fatigue and bone and joint pain, muscle aches and pains, and concentration and memory type problems, you know, and then less commonly we see trouble with abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting. But symptoms don't correlate with your labs. So you can have a pretty, you know, high normal calcium and still have lots of symptoms. And someone else can have a really high calcium and have no symptoms. So that's very dependent. So do the symptoms get better? So definitely they get better. This graph shows the different types of symptoms. So again, the fatigue, muscle aches and pains, weakness. And the people who are in red here are basically people who have had improvement. So we're looking at like a 40% improvement in fatigue, 30% improvement in muscle aches and pains. And then these control patients are patients that we've compared to who had thyroid surgery just to make sure that it wasn't something about neck surgery. If you look at the heartburn, the before patients are in black and after are in gray, and you can see afterwards there's mild reflux as opposed to severe reflux. There's a lot more severe reflux beforehand. Insomnia improves. This is patients who had no insomnia beforehand. And so there's actually some patients who report having more afterwards. But those who did have more insomnia beforehand definitely have a decrease over time. In terms of quality of life, this I think is always the funniest slide or picture to look at. But the bottom line is normal population is this line in blue. And these are each different sort of scales. So one of them might be your physical functioning. Another one's your mental health. You know, another one would be, you know, whether you're having muscle aches and pains, things like that. And so patients with parathyroid disease are here in the white. So if you compare the blue line to the white line, we know that patients with hyperparathyroidism have decreased quality of life. Now, after surgery, so 6 months after surgery, the hyperparathyroid patients are now here in yellow, and they basically go back to the normal population. And so we know that there's, you know, improvements in quality of life. And so these improvements, when you look at patients who've had parathyroid surgery versus none, so they were just observed, include things bodily pain, general health, vitality and mental health. They'll improve on all the quality scales of quality of life measures. And the mild disease patients are actually, there's some data that show they're more improved than the classic patients. So bone improvements, there are definitely some questions about bone improvements. So we see changes here. This shows the lumbar spine, and this shows your femoral neck, or basically your hip, so spine and hip. And if you have surgery, this is the percent that your bone density will improve. So it's not drastic. It's about a 10% improvement over time in your spine density, and a closer to a 15 improvement at the hip, but it definitely improves. And we know that that's associated with a decreased chance of having a fracture. So if one study looked at a bunch of elderly patients, and basically you've probably seen when you get your bone density scores that it's low, these negative numbers are lower. And so if you look at the lumbar spine, which will improve the most at 5 years, some patients will have up to a 30% improvement. And so this goes from osteoporosis to osteopenia. It doesn't usually go back to normal completely, so you're not going to get to a T equal to zero, but you're definitely going to improve. The improvements in the femoral head, basically in the hip, are there's some improvement, and then there's less improvement basically in the wrist or the radial hip. And so if you're looking at fracture risks, this is just a picture showing a fracture. The risk of having some sort of fracture before surgery is increased for up to the 10 years prior to surgery. And it's unrelated to how high your calcium level is. But it returns to normal a year after surgery. So we know that from those bone density improvements that you're less likely to have a fracture afterwards, even if your bone density doesn't go 100% back to normal. A couple of the questions were about bisphosphonates. I'm just taking a sip of water. So the main types of bisphosphonates are Fosamax, Actonel, Bonivia, and Reclast. I've shown them down here. And they're used pre-surgery. It's a little controversial. Some people think that it can make the calcium go lower afterwards. But it's safe to use after surgery, and we know that there's definitely an improvement for the spine bone density that's higher than if you didn't use it at all and you have osteoporosis. We generally recommend waiting at least a month afterwards. And that's mostly because when you take the medication, it makes the calcium in your blood start going back into your bones, and we want to make sure that that low calcium period after surgery is over with already, but there's no study that shows a definite best time. So how about benefits to your heart, cardiac benefits? So we know that your risk of a heart attack is increased, so for up to 10 years prior to surgery. So this is, at the red point, this is surgery, so it's higher than it is down here after surgery, and after surgery it actually returns to normal. In terms of blood pressure, this is a study that showed blood pressure generally improved over the first 6 months after surgery. It may not improve because not all blood pressure is related to the parathyroid, so you may have no change. And we generally recommend working with your primary doctor. The surgeon doesn't usually take over this responsibility, mostly because they're not responsible for all your other medications, and it's easier if one person kind of manages the big picture and your surgeon kind of takes care of the smaller picture. But if you look at this study, this is before surgery numbers. This is after surgery numbers. They had 700 patients, a little over 700 patients in each in the study. And here this was, like, if you look at your blood pressure, the average was 150 over 97, and it decreased to about 130 over 88 on average. And that was a significant change. There are other studies that show no change in blood pressure, and so it's not an absolute, and a lot of that probably has to do with the fact that there are many different causes of blood pressure. The left heart size is something that people talk about, and basically this left side of your heart is the one that pumps all the blood out to your body. And so when you get left ventricular hypertrophy. That basically just means your left heart is muscle is really big because it's working hard, because it's usually because you have high blood pressure. We often see that in patients with asymptomatic hyperparathyroidism, but it can be independent of the blood pressure, so independent of the hypertension. But we know that it correlates with the parathyroid hormone level. And so after surgery, you do parathyroidectomy. This will decreases the left ventricular hypertrophy by 6 months. And so someone had asked about, you know, kind of when to get your heart checked. Oftentimes it's good to wait that 4 to 6 months so these changes can occur before, you know, looking at everything again in terms of your heart. In terms of your kidneys, and we're about halfway through, so just bear with me for a little while. Improvements in kidney function. So this is whether you have kidney failure or some mild kidney dysfunction versus not. I wrote on here basically maybe. These are the headlines from two studies from the same journal a year apart. And one said that surgical cure of primary hyperparathyroidism halts renal failure dysfunction. So basically, it doesn't get any worse. That's a reason to do it. So basically they're showing it doesn't get any worse. Another study, however, showed that there's no evidence that it's useful. And this is very dependent upon how they studied it and who they studied, and that's why we find all these differences and sometimes don't have a definite answer. Here in this study, they basically reviewed 10 different studies and tried to summarize, and basically their general finding was that there was no major change in renal function, but also that it wasn't necessarily getting worse. And so I would say the bottom line is, in terms of improvement in kidney function, some patient will have it, but not all patients will have an improvement, but few get worse. So it tends to stay stable, whereas if you compare it to the general population who has kidney trouble, theirs will get worse over time. Now, kidney stones, we know that kidney stones definitely get better. The sort of biggest journal for medicine is the New England Journal of Medicine. They talk about it in the news a lot. And this study was published quite a while ago. But basically, patients who had kidney stones at baseline, there was 12 of them in the study, they had none afterward. And those patients who had kidney stones but did not have surgery, 75% of them got another kidney stone. And this shows it kind of in a different way, but also explains why some patients still get kidney stones. So if you have hyperparathyroidism and kidney stones or no kidney stones, these are the two blue lines up here, after surgery, you're not gonna get a recurrent stone. But some patients have hyperparathyroidism and kidney stones that are not related to calcium, and so these guys get kidney stones. So each of these little lines going down, some patient having another kidney stone. And so that's basically because this little chart, the calcium stones are the majority of stones, so they're at least 85 to 95% of stones, but not all of them are caused by hyperparathyroidism, and so there's still some patients that will continue to develop stones because it's just not related to parathyroids. And this will show, if you look at patients when it is related to your parathyroids, the risk of developing a stone is above normal, so 4 times normal here, and then after surgery, about 10 years out, it goes back completely to normal, but it doesn't, it's not necessarily immediate. So this is just sort of to summarize again in terms of what kinds of things are going to improve. The biggest things that we know: bone health, your quality of life or well-being, and kidney stones. So another big question that I got beforehand was, how do you know if you're cured? So when are you cured? The newest guidelines for surgery on parathyroids defines cure at 6 months. These are sort of some cure rates. So people will undergo a minimally invasive parathyroid surgery. The cure rate is around 98%. If you just have a bilateral neck exploration without sort of this radio guided, the cure rate can be a little bit lower, closer to, you know, 93% or so. And just in the community, it tends to be even lower by general surgeons in the community, which is why we generally recommend seeing a specialist for parathyroid surgery, just because they don't do quite as many. And so why aren't you cured? So this shows a patient whose thyroid is here and the parathyroids are all in red. And so generally when we go through our small incision in the neck, we can find all these ones here in the middle of the neck pretty easily, but they can be way up high or way down low or even higher, kind of out on the side, and just kind of hard to find. And so that's the biggest reason why patients aren't cured, because you just can't find one of them. And this again shows it a little bit from the side, that people can have them way high, it can be way down low. There's this tissue called your thymus that's just under your breastbone. They can be in there. But most of the time, they're just behind kind of the thyroid, and they can also be inside the thyroid. And so how do we decide who has persistent disease, so they were never cured, or who has recurrence? And so that's based on the labs. So if you never get a normal calcium level within 6 months after surgery, then it's persistent. So basically, if your calcium level is normal after surgery at 6 months and your parathyroid hormone is still a little bit high, as long as it's normal and it wasn't normal beforehand, then we consider that a cure, but you're a little higher risk for recurrence, we know, over time. And then in terms of recurrence, and I'm getting close to the end here, basically patients who have hypercalcemia, so high calcium after surgery, but they had an interval normal calcium level at that 6 month standpoint, so basically the high calcium occurs after 6 months, then those patients are considered recurrent. And the risk is highest when you have the four gland disease, and actually really highest with parathyroid cancer, but it's the least common. And so what do you do if you have persistence? This is one of the questions that someone submitted. Basically, find an experienced parathyroid surgeon is the number one thing. And bring all your records. And then they're going to want to do a whole bunch of different studies to try to find it. The selective venous sampling is something where they use similar to cardiac catheterization, but they're going to look at the vessels in your, you know, near your thyroid. They go in your groin. Then they come up with little catheters. And so it's selective if they just come on the right side and the left side, and highly selective if they actually try to get the catheters into these little tiny little vessels around there and try to figure out exactly where that parathyroid is. In terms of long-term follow-up, you should get your calcium and your parathyroid hormone level checked post surgery, and then again at 6 months to make sure you're cured. And then after that, as long as everything's normal, we recommend only checking the calcium. And not, there's no need to check the parathyroid hormone level. Because the bone density takes about 6 to 12 months to really recover and improve, we usually don't recommend checking the bone density test until you're about a year out. And then depending upon that, what that shows, check it afterwards. How about calcium and vitamin D supplements? So everyone should get enough calcium and vitamin D in their diet. So you can either get it in your diet or use supplements. And most of our sort of population of who's listening, I'm guessing, is either in the purple or the orange box. But you need to get at least 1,000 to 1,200 milligrams of calcium and 600 to 800 milligrams of vitamin D. And that's the recommended dietary allowance that's, you know, set by the Food and Drug Administration. It has nothing to do with parathyroid disease. And so after surgery and your cure, we do recommend everybody stay on some sort of calcium if they're not getting enough in their diet. These were some of the other questions that we had, but I want to make sure that we have time for everybody who's listening to ask their questions. I just wanted to point out at the University of Wisconsin, the number of these that we do a year has been increasing year after year. We need to update this, but we're one of the highest volume centers in the country for this type of surgery. These are a couple web resources that you can go to, and then I'm happy to take any questions. Sure. I'll get to see what it looks like. And go ahead, if you have questions, you can type them into your screen on the bottom or sort of on the right side there. We've tried to go over that beforehand, but good evening. The couple of things that I did get in terms of questions that nobody had asked about or I hadn't covered that I just got today is sort of some last minute things. One was people who can get sometimes numbness or tingling even though their labs are in the normal range. We think that's because of a relative drop. So your calcium level starts at 12 and it goes down to 9. You may still have symptoms the same as if somebody starts at 10 and they go down to 7. It's just because there's that much of a change from where you were at baseline. And then somebody else had asked about if there's any concerns getting x-rays or mammograms or anything else, and there's really not. That's all okay and something that you should do as your primary care doctor recommends. One of the questions I see here about various types of kind of recovery rates among hyperparathyroid patients, and I would say definitely. It's hard to predict. I tell everyone that you're going to feel better afterwards. I just can't tell you how or when. a lot of the symptoms of hyperparathyroidism are caused by other things as well, and so you never know what's going to improve. So, I have, a couple patients I saw today, their fatigue is already gone, they're sleeping better already, they've had no change, say, in their blood pressure, they're still having some muscle aches and pains. And so some of them we do see improve a little bit sooner, but it all depends a little bit on how, how long you've been having your symptoms beforehand, and really just sort of how much the calcium does or doesn't change in that initial time period. So I think that's a great question, and we definitely do see differences in recovery. So it's hard. You can't compare yourself to your neighbor or friend or whoever else you know who had surgery. So one of the questions I see here is, if a surgeon does not look at all of your remaining parathyroids when there was one adenoma and a negative MIBI, what is the percent of recurrence? So we know that it's higher when you haven't looked at all four glands. I would say that's kind of newer within the last 2 to 3 years that we've realized that. The standard of care had always been looking at all four glands. And then recently that changed to looking, or I would say not recently, about 15 years ago that changed to trying to just do them looking at one gland and if we could find it. And so sometimes that MIBI, that negative MIBI will be negative, but you see it on ultrasound, and so you can still go in and find it. I think a lot of surgeons are having much lower thresholds of looking at all four of them because we know that they can come back over time. And so the percent of recurrence, I would say, it varies in the literature. It can be anywhere from, say 3% up to 15 or 20%. I'm not sure if anyone's looked at it very specifically by what imaging tests were or weren't positive or negative beforehand. We do think, though, that patients who have had just one gland looked at and not at least another one on the other side may be at a little bit higher risk, but that data is actually very new and a little controversial. So in terms of practices, even among experts in the country, some people are still just going after one and some are looking at all four. I see another question here. If one has hyperplasia and has only one or half gland left, what is the risk of recurrence? So there's still a risk of recurrence, and again, for that it's a little bit variable depending upon what whose studies you look at, and I'm sure that's just because most of the studies we have, it's we're comparing the University of Wisconsin versus, say, Vanderbilt University versus University of California, Los Angeles, UCLA, and so that's why we see different, and so you're basically comparing specific little groups of surgeons to each other. And so again, that, you know, you'll hear anywhere from 2 to 3% up to 10 or 15%. It's hard when you only have one gland or half a gland left if you do have recurrence, because you only have that one piece of tissue. So the question is, do we go in and try to trim it down, but you might lose its blood supply, or do we go in and take it out and put part of it, you know, into your arm, or people can put them into the muscles in their neck or leg or other places, but the arm's kind of the most common, but that only works about 75% of the time. And so, you know, recurrence is always a very difficult thing to manage, and so some surgeons will watch it until you actually get symptoms, and so therefore you're actually improving something as opposed to just operating on the lab numbers. I hope that answered your question. I'm going to sip some water here. We have about time for one more question or so. So if anybody has one, go ahead and type it in. I'll look through my sheets here and see if there was anything else that was on here that I know I didn't answer. Let's see. Someone had asked, there's one up here. I'll answer that. Afterwards, someone had asked about a link between hyperparathyroidism and breast cancer. They think that there's some of the medications you can take for treatment of breast cancer can lead to hyperparathyroidism, but not between the hyperparathyroidism and the cancer itself, say from a genetic standpoint. In terms of getting pre-op bone density testing, the bone density testing is generally recommended for postmenopausal women basically over the age of 50, which is the guidelines nationally for anyone even without hyperparathyroidism. We try to get that done sort of either before or just shortly afterwards, because it does take the bone some time to rebuild. If patients have multiple other indications for surgery, then sometimes we'll just wait till that year point afterwards and check that as sort of, you know, that's your new baseline, and then see if it's improving from there. And mostly because there's not a ton of other treatment you're going to do in the meantime. But if you've never had one and you're over the age of 50, it's generally recommended or in postmenopausal. Anything else quick?
If not, thank you so much everyone for coming, for joining us tonight. Have a wonderful night.
Thank you all for your attendance.